I'm calling the May 12, 2011 Cape Cod Commission meeting to order. And the first item of the agenda is roll call. Michael.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Barnstable, Royden Richardson.
Present.
Bourne, Michael Blanton. I am present. Brewster, Elizabeth Taylor.
I am also present.
Thank you. Chatham, Lynn Pleffner.
I'm over here.
Dennis, Richard Roy. Eastham, Joy Brookshire. Falmouth, Mario D. Gregorio. Harwich, Robert Bradley.
Here.
Mashpee, Ernest Virgilio. Orleans, Leonard Short.
Here.
Welcome aboard. Provincetown, Austin Knight.
Present.
Sandwich, Joanne O'Keefe.
Present.
Truro, Peter Graham.
Here.
Wellfleet, Roger Putnam.
Here.
Yarmouth, John McCormick Jr.
Here.
Minority Representative, John Harris. Native American Representative, Mark Harding. Governor's Appointee, Herb Olson.
Here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It looks like we have a quorum.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is public comment, and public comment is reserved for comments by the public on anything that is not included on today's agenda. Is anybody who wishes to speak? Yes.
Yes, Mr. Chair, and members of the Commission, Jessica Wilgus, Commission Counsel. We do have one item that is up for public comment, and I just wanted to remind the members that while this is not an agenda item or something to be discussed, it is under review currently by us, and I would suggest it's not something up for discussion, but for you to receive at this point.
Members of the Commission, my name is Paul Revere. I spoke with Ms. Wilgus beforehand about speaking about this issue. What I'm going to speak briefly about is it relates to the New Generation Project and how the Commission is proceeding procedurally with the matter. Basically, as some of you might read in the papers, the proponents of the New Generation Wind Project have now filed a subdivision for their 370-acre property. Amongst this group, I don't think I have to tell any of you that a 370-acre property is massive and that a subdivision of that property is a mandatory DRI. As of this date, the Commission has not received the mandatory DRI referral for that matter. It is expected from my discussions with the Bourne Planning Department to be signed tonight at the Planning Board meeting. With that said, there is scheduled for next Tuesday evening in Bourne the opening of the first substantive public hearing on the New Generation Project, which is on exactly that same piece of property. And I think it is inappropriate, and I have sent an email to the Commission and to the Commission staff and a letter which the chairman has explaining this, to start a DRI on one piece of property when there is a second DRI, which should be here before that public hearing opens, on exactly the same property. And there are a number of reasons that I'll just sort of outline. One is the two projects become interrelated as to building envelopes and relating to turbines, et cetera. As they say, I don't want to get into any of the substance. A secondary thing is that the project apparently was filed, and I'm not going to get into the legal issues, but to grandfather the project from a new Bourne zoning bylaw relating to wind turbines. Okay. Well,
Mr. Chairman, I have a point of order. Could you help me?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Whereas we are meeting in a subcommittee, is it appropriate for us to hear this at this time, or should I wait until the 17th? Thank you.
Based on advice of counsel, I preferenced it. I think it's appropriate, given the timeliness of the issue, for Attorney Revere to make his comments to the Commission but commissioners should refrain from asking any sort of detailed questions or entering into any sort of deliberative process. But given the timeliness of it, it's appropriate public comment for Mr. Revere to raise his concerns and to give it to us in writing. And any substantive discussion will take place on 17th.
Right. And in no way, I think I'm specifically trying not to address anything as to either project.
Yeah, okay. Just continue, Mr. Revere.
Okay.
Thank you.
Specifically, as I said, was submitted in an attempt to avoid a new bylaw. Well, in terms of making a decision, ultimately the subcommittee will have to decide whether it's the current new generation plan is consistent with local bylaws, but we won't know what bylaw applies until the subdivision goes completely through its process. And I'm not going to get into the legal issues of that, but I think it shows how they're tied. Finally, commission regulations say the project should not be segmented. This would result in segmenting if we start a hearing with only one of two things on the same property. Lastly, and this is a kind of interesting point, and really why I'm here, full disclosure, I do represent an abutter. In the last month, couple months, new wind turbine regulations were promulgated. The standards that are in effect for a project are those that are in effect on the date the first substantive hearing opens. As it stands right now, staff's position is that the new regulations standards are not in effect for this project. If the public hearing is opened on the 17th, the first substantive hearing, and staff's position is upheld, this, probably the largest land-based wind project that will ever be seen before the commission, will not have those standards apply. When I look at the whole big picture, there's nothing forcing the commission to open a hearing next Tuesday for the new generation project, and under the circumstances, the two projects ought to be combined, the subdivision and the wind project, and the substantive hearing shouldn't be opened till a time when the new standards apply. I leave it as that. I want to make this statement publicly so that staff could get the input of the commission if they decide to make a decision or to do something different in terms of the hearing on Tuesday. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there any other public comment? Seeing none, the executive director's report, please. Paul.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to bring to the commission members' attention the fact that our new Congressman Bill Keating is having an open house on Thursday, May 19th from 9 to 5 at his office at 297 North Street in Suite 312, and that's in Hyannis. So we have an invitation. It's in your packet today. Anyone who's interested in stopping by, say hello. Secondly, I wanted to report on the Smarter Cape Summit that was held at the Wequosset Inn on Monday and Tuesday. So it was a summit that combined four organizations, the Cape Cod Commission, the Regional Chamber of Commerce, Open Cape, and the Cape Cod Tech Collaborative. Got together, and generally we all have spring meetings of some sort, and we're all talking to the same 300 people. So we decided to get together and save everybody that sort of travel time. And obviously there's a common theme between a lot of what we're trying to do here at the commission with the chamber, and Open Cape has really been the backbone of that. It is one of the 16 SEDS projects that we worked on 2 years ago. And Open Cape has sort of been living with us at the commission until their building on top of the hill is ready. So there's been a lot of synergy, and I think it was a great example of organizations that in the past have actually not seen eye to eye on issues. There have been a lot of turf issues between some of these organizations in the past, but over the last few years we've all agreed that we are moving in the same direction, and we've identified roles and responsibilities, and in doing that we've been able to develop a certain synergy that allowed us to have a very successful Smarter Cape Summit on Monday and Tuesday. Congressman Keating opened up the session on Monday afternoon, and the governor came down and closed it out on Tuesday afternoon. It was very well attended. There were a lot of members there, and a lot of public officials, and a lot of business folks, too. So it was a great interaction, and I think it was a huge success, and I believe the four organizations are committed to following this up next year. But I did quote Roger, our own Roger Putnam, at the opening of the event, because Roger, once upon a time, informed the county EDC that they shouldn't be in the business of sending Valentines to themselves. And I like that quote. And and that's not what a lot of these conferences or these local events, you see these annual events, that's what it is. It's a celebration of how great we are and the good things that we do. This was not that. This was about setting out an agenda to get certain things done that relate to Open Cape and the broadband initiative, and really, I think, begins to suggest a paradigm shift in how we think about economic vitality here on the Cape, and how we can couple that with environmental protection, and really a new and absolutely necessary era of collaboration as it relates to the big issues that we're facing, whether it's wastewater or renewable energy. So I thought it was a great conference, and we hope to do it again next year. And then finally, I just want to welcome our newest member from Orleans, Len Short, who joins us here today and brings with him a great deal of wastewater experience, which will be invaluable to us as we move forward over the next 12 to 18 months. So welcome aboard, Len. And with that, I'm done unless anyone has any questions.
I have an observation that I'd like to make in terms of the conferences held at Wequosset. I've attended a lot of conferences, workshops in my lifetime, and I have never been one that was more invigorating and more challenging and more well thought through, and the Cape Cod Commission can be very proud of the participation of its executive director and the staff that participated. It was quite an outstanding experience, and I think we all have reason to be very, very pleased and proud. And having said that, I would like to have Peter, excuse me, please.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, if I may, I would also like to comment on the conference. I think what I observed a great deal of it wasn't so much people felt that they came to take something away from it, but more from what they could contribute to it. And there was a real sense of that in terms of collaboration and looking at how we get to the next steps. And there was a lot of excitement around that, knowing that there is a great potential here in Cape Cod, and with the four organizations that put it together, that people felt that there the optimism that good things can happen as a result of the conference. And I think the fact that Congressman Keating took the time to come and the governor took the time to come down, I think that is a reflection of the work that the group was doing. And it was very important, and I think they recognized that, and they contributed to it in their own way. So I agree with you. It was an excellent conference,
right.
And thank Paul and all of his contributors.
Thank you. All right, is anybody else want to say anything else about the conference? Michael, excuse me, I can.
Not about the conference, although the conference was actually fantastic. I wanted to correct an oversight, if I may, as evidenced by her comments when I called roll. The Barnstable County Commission Rep, Mary Pat Flynn, is indeed present.
Yes, did somebody else have their hand up? Okay. I would like to ask Peter Monger to come forward.
Peter, I just wanted to let you know that how much we've all appreciated your participation on the Cape Cod Commission and the very fine and reasoned contribution you made to our work together. I particularly have appreciated serving on a couple of subcommittees with you, and I think that we found the good communication. And I think as I thought about this, and I was thinking that we would miss you, as a matter of fact,
But I also realize that you have become part of a very, very large group of people, and having had the privilege of serving on the Cape Cod Commission, the life that we share together, we come as very, very individual type people. And as we talk and listen together, we're able to come to decisions that hopefully will help us keep this a pretty special place. It's given us an opportunity to learn, it's given us an opportunity to share, and then also to put into practice what we have learned. And so I wish you well, and I know every commissioner here wishes you well, and we'd like to give you this. And the box is here that you can put it in if you want, take it home.
I'm going to hang it straight.
Okay. And maybe you'd like to say something.
I would, actually.
Yeah.
I would like to thank the members of the commission for making my time here a very enjoyable one. I really did enjoy working with you. I'm going to miss you all. I hope to run into you away from the commission from time to time. But thank you for making a very pleasurable experience. And to the staff, you guys are just terrific. You make an almost incomprehensible job very doable. And I thank you for all your help and assistance that you give me over my time here. Thank you.
Thank you all.
And the next thing on the agenda is the minutes of our April 14, 2011 meeting.
I'll move the minutes as presented.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor will signify by saying, accepting them will say, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Any abstentions? A couple of abstentions here. Good. Okay, we do have a new member from Orleans, and it says from New Orleans. I'm sure they mean new from Orleans. Leonard Short, maybe you'd like to say hello to everybody?
Hello.
You can speak right into the microphone there.
I hope it's being recorded as the day goes on. Thank you.
Yeah. Welcome.
Welcome. And Elizabeth, report of the nominating committee.
Yes, I had expected Ernie might be here, but he is not. We have a slate of officers consisting of Peter Graham for chairman, Michael Blanton for vice chairman. And since no one seemed to be interested in being clerk, I volunteered. Which I've done before, but I must say, if there are any members here who would like to be clerk, please let us know right now, and you can put yourself in my place and be the clerk, and I don't see any hands up. Okay, well, I'm on the agenda then for the clerk, and that is the slate of officers.
Well, that's a good slate of officers.
Do you want a motion to approve the slate as presented?
And this is not time for that yet. Jessica, do you want to...
I'm just trying to move it along, that's all.
Yeah, the process is that at this meeting you accept the nomination, and at your next regularly scheduled meeting you will take up the election.
Okay. All right. And on to the next item. Have public hearing, Forestdale Village procedural denial, and there is a hearing notice, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hearing notice for the Cape Cod Commission, Forestdale Village, May 12, 2011. The Cape Cod Commission will conduct a public hearing on Thursday, May 12, 2011 at 3 p.m. in the First District Courthouse Assembly of Delegates Chamber, Route 6A, Barnstable, Massachusetts. The following Development of Regional Impact, or DRI, has been referred to the Cape Cod Commission under Section 13A of the Cape Cod Commission Act, Chapter 716 of the Acts of 1989, as amended, and Sections 3 and 7 of the DRI Enabling Regulations. The purpose of the final hearing is to allow for proposed corrections to and comments on factual information contained in the draft written decision, a procedural denial without prejudice. This notice is being published as required by Section 5 of the Cape Cod Commission Act. The project name, Forestdale Village. The project applicant, Pimlico Pines Realty LLC, Stephen G. Powers. Project location, 74 and 76 Route 130, Forestdale, Massachusetts. And the project description, according to the Development of Regional Impact Referral Form, the proposed project will involve 100,000 square feet of commercial development. And I do have a
right, thank you very much. And staff, Andrea Adams.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the record, my name is Andrea Adams. I'm the Cape Cod Commission's Senior Regulatory Planner. In your packet today, you should have had a memorandum explaining the reasons the project is before you today, copies of emails from the applicant, a copy of the enabling regulations describing the procedural denial standards, and a copy of a draft decision. In brief, the Cape Cod Commission received a referral of the Forestdale Village project in October 2010 from Greg Smith, the Director of Planning and Development. And I would just note for the record that both Mr. Powers, who's the applicant, and Mr. Smith were sent a copy of the cover memo dated May 12th. And the draft decision. And as of this afternoon, when I came over to the meeting today, neither one of them had sent any comments on that document. In fact, I'd received an email from Mr. Powers apologizing, saying that he had had a conflict and would be unable to attend the meeting today. To get back to explaining the background, again, the Commission's enabling regulations require that a public hearing be open within 60 days of the receipt of a referral, which was in December 2010. The applicant was informed of this in a letter in October 2010. In an email received on November 19th, the applicant's representatives indicated they were working on a development of regional impact application, but again, by December of last year, the applicant had not submitted anything, so the hearing period was opened by a hearing officer. Again, the enabling regulations of the Commission require the hearing period to be closed within 90 days. That date was March 16th of this year. The applicant was again informed by email by Commission staff that in January we sent him an email, or I sent him an email, and by letter in February, but again, nothing had been received. So the hearing period was closed by hearing officer on March 16th. Commission staff was also informed by a letter from the applicant in February that because the DRI application, or because they had not filed the DRI application, they could either withdraw or be procedurally denied without prejudice. And ultimately, the applicant contacted Commission staff by email on March 9th requesting the procedural denial. I would just note for the record that the regulatory committee, as part of the process, has to take up procedural denials to give applicants an opportunity to speak to commission members in their role as regulatory committee members. And at that meeting in April, which occurred, Mr. Powers did attend, and he had said that he was having problems with his engineer, that when he had met at a previous occasion with commission staff had noticed a discrepancy in the water resources area and had pointed that out to him, and he had asked his consulting engineer to look at the information and had discovered that not only were the stormwater management calculations incorrect, but that were cascading errors throughout the project that would make him unable to proceed with a filing. So basically, he said at that point he needed to rectify that before he could go forward, and that was the basis for requesting his procedural denial. In terms of the Commission's regulations, procedural denials are governed by Section 15, and in relevant part, the Commission can undertake a procedural denial if the applicant fails to submit a completed application, or in other instances where the project fails to progress expeditiously through our regulatory process. And I think in this case, it's evident from the record that that is occurring with Forest Hill Village. So in total, the regulatory committee, as I noted, takes this up first to give an applicant an opportunity to explain what's going on to commission members. And the regulatory committee did that in March. It was actually in March. The regulatory committee did that, and at that meeting, they voted to recommend to the full commission acceptance of the procedural denial without prejudice. And basically, in your packet, you have a draft decision memorializing that, dated today. I just briefly go through it. The top part talks about who the applicant is, gives a brief description of the project. All we have to go on is what's on the referral form. That's why it's so short. It gives the procedural history of how we got to this point, gives an indication of the commission's jurisdiction, the materials submitted for the record, a discussion of what went on at the regulatory committee, and the various findings that match the requirements in Section 15 of the enabling regulations. So in total, commission staff believes, and as evidenced by the regulatory committee's vote in March, that the commission can, in good faith, grant Mr. Powers, Pimlico Pines Realty, a procedural denial without prejudice for the Forest Hill Village project. That's all I have at this point. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Are there any questions for Andrea? I don't see any. I'll ask the clerk, please put this into motion form, and we'll vote on it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move that the commission grant Stephen G. Powers and Pimlico Pines Realty LLC a procedural denial without prejudice for the Forest Hill Village project in Sandwich.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All right. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? One abstention. It passes, and thank you very much. The next item on the agenda is the Cape Cod Commission Subcommittee Procedures, which we have in the packet also, I believe. Jessica?
Yes. Good afternoon. My name is Jessica Wilgus. I'm Commission Counsel. Before you, you have the proposed revisions to the Cape Cod Commission Subcommittee Procedures. And this is an item that we have some technical edits that I have to bring before you. Packet with the redline version that you have before you was brought before the regulatory committee preceding this, and the full committee unanimously recommended to submit these to you for your approval. Essentially, there are two themes that are in here that are deal with the amendments that are being presented. Two things. The first is, over the past year or so, when we have conducted some trainings and some outreach to the members, you have expressed an interest in having people who come before you be sworn in when they testify and give you evidence. And that's one change that's proposed in these subcommittee procedures, is encapsulating that so it's a formality, so that going forward this will occur. On all DRIs that you have before you in both the subcommittee and the full commission. And I'll walk you through these changes in a moment. And the second major change that's in here is just acknowledging the time periods that are allowed by the Cape Cod Commission Act. In particular, there is a hearing period that we are required to adhere to. And with that, we have 90 days. And the subcommittee procedures reflect that, so that when a subcommittee receives the information, they have the 90-day hearing period to accept new information. After that time period, the hearing will close and a re-noticing will occur before the full commission, and we wanted to make sure that the subcommittee procedures reflect that reality as well. So I will just walk you through these changes, and if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. On page two is the first group of changes. Some of these are just clarifying in nature. The first one in subsection three, which is the selection of subcommittees and member attendance, we're just highlighting the fact that if at the time of subcommittee selection, if you know that you are not able to attend that first public hearing or that you're going to be out for some period of time, if you can raise that, as well as if you have a conflict of interest, you raise that initially with commission staff so that we can start with a full committee. The second change is that in order to vote on the subcommittee recommendation, a subcommittee member must have attended all of the substantive public hearings, and we wanted to bring up subcommittee meetings as well, because that's an important component of that. And then an alternate can participate, provided they have participated in all the substantive public meetings and hearings, if there is a vacancy that occurs. In terms of the site visit on page four, we wanted to just highlight, and you know, this is known, but I think just solidifying this, is that the site visit itself is not a public meeting. The purpose of it is simply to give you context for a project, and that no testimony or discussion takes place at that site visit. So we just put in the statutory site for that, in case anyone were to raise any questions about the site visit itself. The remainder on that page is just highlighting the commission's... Yes.
Just a minute.
Question? Yes.
While we're there?
Yes.
It says, let's see, that's second. For site visit, we're just prior to your red lettering there.
Yes.
The sentence, the line above, the site visit is not a time at which the applicant or town officials may present new information. Would that be correct?
It is correct. Is it for anyone to present new information? So,
okay. I know from a consistency standpoint, I think later it mm-hmm. says town officials. Just a suggestion to add.
We could certainly make that addition. And should I proceed to the next section, or are there any other questions?
Yes.
Do you want to go back, or do you want to hear us as we move along?
Whatever your preference is.
I have a little picayune thing on page three.
Yep.
Just for language, under four.
Yes.
Staff will work throughout the course, regulatory members with information and analysis. Instead of so, could we put in order that? So is such a so word. So word.
That should be fine.
Thank you.
Anything else? Okay, Roger.
Mr. Chairman, I find it difficult to understand how you can have a site visit and not be asking the proponent certain questions which you didn't know beforehand. Otherwise, what's the purpose of the site visit? Merely to gaze at the property?
It really is. The purpose of it is to gaze at the property and give yourself context, so when you go to the public hearing and they make the presentation, they will say, today or whenever it took place, you may have noticed the change in grade in this particular location. But it is not a time for discussion.
Doesn't obviate the purpose of the site visit, though? I mean, to my mind, the site visit is to get educated on the site, not merely to... Why don't you send us a postcard then, instead of making us travel to the thing? If all we're going to do is look at the property.
If someone is familiar with the site, then perhaps they would have that context. But the purpose of the site visit is so that all the subcommittee members are on the same playing field and that they have the same context.
Well, just send us
context.
A picture then. Don't bother with the site visit if all the purpose is to look at it. I mean, to my mind, it's to mm-hmm. gather information about it, and you do that talking to the site man, you talk to his engineers, you talk to people involved. I mean, it's to gather information, not just merely to gaze at it. Seriously, I don't know how you're going to avoid it.
I can bring you the statue, we can go through it, but certainly
then
we do need to...
Then why do we bother with a site visit? Why don't you send us a picture?
Because it doesn't give you the same context. You're not able to look around. And this is something that we will be taking up at our retreat which I hope you're all coming to on May 23rd, and this will be a topic of discussion, and we certainly can further discuss it.
The answer is no, why bother to discuss it? I mean, this, to my mind, is foolish to have a site visit where you can't talk to the people involved.
All right.
Enough said.
Okay. Yes.
Wouldn't you just want to ask questions?
And I think I have mentioned this already, but certainly any questions you have about discussing the project should be reserved for the public hearing, so which will take place immediately following, usually. So that is, and you have to give everyone, the whole public, an opportunity to hear what you are raising so that they have an opportunity to be heard if they have a comment about any issues that you may have raised. It's an appealable issue if you have discussions about the project outside of the public hearing process. So we can further discuss, but that it's a definite necessity to proceed that way. On page 5,
Jessica?
Yes.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Yes, just a minute. Ooh. Yes.
On Lynn. Page 4,
yes.
Site visit, sorry.
Yes.
But I think you should add the word a site visit is not a public
You're right.
meeting.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. On page 5 is the language that solidifies the ability for the chair to swear in. All individuals who will present information to the subcommittee during the public hearing process. And the way that we've set this up is that the chair is able to collectively swear in everyone who has signed in to have a presentation or a discussion before you, rather than have every person come up and do that over repeatedly in an effort to save time. Obviously, we understand that sometimes there are people who will come in late to the proceeding and they would have to be individually sworn in, but as a matter of practical circumstance, we try to do it at the outset if possible. Subsections 5.
Excuse me,
have more comment.
Chairman. Jessica, yeah, what form would that take, just so I get an idea of what we're talking about?
Just to be, I swear that the testimony I'm about to give is the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth. And they will raise their hand and swear in, and then when they testify, and what you, one of the reasons this also came forward, you may recall before in Cape Wind matter, the Keyspan matter, they found that our proceedings were not sufficiently adjudicatory in nature because we did not have a lot of the objective things that are conducted in what they consider an adjudicatory proceeding for purposes of taking the record below and using it in another proceeding. So this is a way of increasing the ability that the Cape Cod Commission record can be used later on as well. So that was another purpose. On page 5, when we look at sections 6 through 8, this speaks to the question of closing the hearing and the record once that hearing period has concluded. And once it has concluded, we are not allowed by statute to accept additional material or testimony. And this just solidifies that that fact. On page 6, under credentials.
Yes.
I'd like to go back to the swearing in. Does that mean everyone that comes before a hearing will be mandated to be sworn in?
Yes.
And is that enforceable in any way?
These procedures.
And if they refuse to be sworn in?
They refuse to be sworn in.
Then they can't be heard?
They shouldn't be heard.
But then what?
They should not be heard.
They should not be
heard.
That's
part of the process.
And will there be a disclaimer somewhere that that the folks just say that they may not want to be sworn in, that there's some sort of notice that, you know, on documents of public hearings that on our, when we send it out, that we are now mandating that they be sworn in so that they know in advance and are not in surprise?
Other than having these out there, certainly the chair will be announcing at the beginning of a hearing. I think it goes to the veracity of their testimony, and if someone is refusing to be sworn in and verify what their testimony is going to be, that speaks to their credibility as well.
Thank you.
Just a little comment on that. It's to give the testimony standing, and that when we go to other, you know, groups that have authority to impose things, they can't say to us, well, you didn't do it this way, you just took comments. And this gives the comments, you know, some strength. And I think the other thing that came out in one of the subcommittees that we had, we did get testimony from an individual regarding, and we all felt that perhaps that wasn't exactly true. And we were, you know, and I think it makes people, would make people realize the importance of the procedure that they were involved in if they have to swear that they're telling the truth. And anyway, Michael.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I think also the goal that we were wanting to arrive at wasn't something that was going to be an onerous, lengthy procedure. We were talking about maybe swearing in all individuals en masse at the beginning of testimony, correct?
That's right. Yes.
Yes, please.
Mr. Chairman, what about written testimony? If somebody doesn't want to swear in, they can just hand in written testimony, couldn't they?
They could, yes.
So.
Yes, and again, you may recall, I mean, this is just part of the administration of the hearing, but certainly as quasi-judicial members of the commission, you are ultimately the arbiters of what you deem credible in any particular situation. So you are supposed to weigh the evidence you have in front of you and make findings as you deem suitable. And this is just a tool in enabling you to do that.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, it seems to me that when I first came on the commission a couple of years ago, maybe not that long ago, but we had a couple of gentlemen address a couple of subcommittees, and this was one of the recommendations.
And yes.
I think it's a good thing, but probably something like this should be announced at the opening of a subcommittee hearing,
yes.
And maybe a sign-up sheet should state that anyone who wants to speak has to be sworn.
That's right. And what you're referring to is we did have municipal training, and Bob Ritchie came and spoke to us, and this was one of his recommendations that we proceed this way.
Okay. Elizabeth?
Could something indicating that this will be done be part and parcel of all of our notifications?
I wouldn't make it part of the official hearing notice because it's not technically required, but if you wanted, we could put something on the website, or we could certainly announce it at every meeting.
That would be helpful.
Okay. The remainder of the items that we have are mostly editing, in particular in subsection 7. We reference probable benefits, but don't carry the probable, and it's the statute requires probable detriments. Subcommittee members are the ones asking questions at subcommittee meetings. On page 8, the subcommittee recommendations, we just wanted to make sure that within the subcommittee recommendations that it actually spells out that we expect you to make findings as part of your decision-making process. And subsection 9 is just an outline of the general process by which a subcommittee proceeds, and one of the first items that we added in is the swearing in, referencing that takes place. And page 9, ex parte communications, this is one area that the regulatory committee did ask for some editing in there, in that as you may recall, during the hearing process, it's advised that you not have contact with outside parties outside of the hearing process. And it's not just the applicants that we are hoping that you refrain from speaking to. It's also opponents and proponents of the project. So that's why that language was added. And finally, on page 10 and 11, we added in just because it wasn't reflected in the process outline before, some of the steps that are taken with MEPA, if it is indeed a project that went through MEPA. And lastly, in subsection 13, we just put in the procedure in there that the 60-day decision period may be extended by agreement between the applicant and the commission, because that's certainly available, and we thought that would be something good to highlight if someone were reading the subcommittee procedures for the first time and knew that was something they could avail themselves of. So that's everything I have, and I see questions, so.
Yes. All right. Elizabeth?
Just one comment on the ex parte communications. I don't think you've really covered adequately the fact that you shouldn't be discussing it with anyone, because you specifically say applicants, opponents, proponents, or the representatives. You know, if my neighbor wants to talk to me about it, I'm not supposed to talk with them. If the press contacts me or my public officials, I cannot discuss it with them. And I think we need to change the description that you just do not have any contact mm-hmm. or discussion with anyone outside of your public hearing or your subcommittee meeting
right.
process.
I think, you know, and tell me if you're comfortable with this, but it does reference the commission's communication policy, which in and of itself is a large document, which covers all of the possible circumstances that could arise in relation to this. We certainly, I can flesh this out a little bit, but in the hopes of not replicating that policy within the subcommittee procedures, that's why we cross-referenced that document.
Okay. Anybody else? Peter?
Yeah, to open up another bag of worms back to Roger's bag of worms. You know, I think part of this conversation about what happens at a site visit is the fact that I've participated in site visits, and they do and have been a full free range. You know, the applicant shows up, town officials show up, staff shows up, and questions are asked of the applicant, staff, and town officials, you know, all at once. There's a whole lot of information that is exchanged at those site visits that what I'm hearing now is that is a big no-no. I mean, that, you know, maybe it's overreaction, but that could legally jeopardize the proceedings.
You're correct. And that's part of why I'm highlighting it for you, because, again, this is something that it's this, and I know I always use this analogy, but this is very much your hearing a DRI is very much like a trial. And in a trial, when the jury goes on a bus on a site visit, they are ushered on the bus, and the plaintiff and defense counsel are not allowed to speak about the case whatsoever. What they can do is say, for example, if there's some kind of anything particular to the site that they want to raise later, they can say, notice there's a hill over here. Notice the grading changes here. Take a look at the phragmites in the field over here. And then when they go back into the public hearing and they make their argument, they will say, you may remember when you went out for that site visit, this hill over here, it wasn't possible for him to go over there because it was all full of mud and he couldn't do that. You know, whatever the argument was, but you cannot, and the applicant should know better, they should not be trying to influence you in the process of the site visit itself. And that's one thing I think we want to clarify now. You know, whether or not it was done in the past, it's something that when it's highlighted in our procedures, the legally proper way is just to illustrate the surroundings, and that's it.
Roger?
At the risk of whipping a dead horse, this whole thing is really doesn't, it involves what I call a breach of common sense. I mean, why do you go to a site visit and not want to learn anything? I mean, you've got town of people there, you've got the developer or whoever is there, you've got all the people who are involved in it, and you're going to sit there and try and remember questions. I can't remember what I forgot not to ask them. You know, What are you going to say when you get to the next step? In effect, why not make this part of the public process then, and then we can talk to them?
Because I think you're missing the fact that this is not part of the public process.
Well, why not make it part of the public process?
Because
then?
It's against the law, Chapter 38, Section 18. It is not a public
well,
meeting.
This whole thing defies common sense. You go to a site visit and you can't talk to people. Foolish.
Let me offer one thing. I think that the work that you do is extremely important. And if you think about all the time and all the packets that you receive and all the information that you go through to make a decision, subcommittee meets extensively, has the public hearings, make a recommendation, we come here, you write a decision. At the end of the day, if on a technicality, someone is to complain, that is to appeal that decision, they could essentially nullify all of your work. And that's a reason.
Has it ever happened?
Yes.
When?
There's a whole body of case law about that.
Not public hearings involving the Cape Cod Commission. I'm talking about.
This is a matter of common sense for a body that's not a legal body. We are a commission. Look at what we're empowered to do by the Commission Act. And to my mind, all I'm doing here is arguing for common sense, because common sense is what we need to make the right kind of decision on a DRI.
Okay,
not the. And I've said enough. Thank you.
Just a point of clarification, everything that Jessica, I mean, we're sort of bound by the body of law that's out there as it relates to this, but the reason for the site visits are to give you know, some of you that are going to be making these important, when you sit in as a regulatory subcommittee, you are serving in a quasi-judicial capacity. So it's different than other actions the commission takes more broadly pursuant to the act. But in that quasi-judicial capacity, there has to be an opportunity for the public to hear information the same time that you're hearing information, and you all have to hear the same kind of information at the same time. There is not always the opportunity to allow the public onto the site, which is why, you know, one of the reasons why these site visits are curtailed, and there's not supposed to be, you're there to feel it, see it, touch it, to give you reference points, to write down questions you might have based on your visit to the site, and then to go back to a public hearing, which generally happens right after the site visit, where the public can be present and can benefit from hearing the kind of questions that you have, having the context of being to the site. So that's, I hate to be the defender of something that's not common sense, but that's sort of the situation that we're at on site visits. It's really, in many respects, the limitation of the public to be present when there's any sort of deliberation happening as you sit in a quasi-judicial capacity.
Just my own experience when I first came to the commission and went on my first few site visits, the thing that was most concerning to me was that discussion was taking place that truly the public should have been able to hear. And you can't invite the town to come to a small. And I think it's important that the discussion be public, and it, that we don't enter into any kind of understanding without people observing it. Yes, Michael. Okay, Joanne.
Just for the history, I've been on two site visits, and well prepared by staff members, and staff members are present. And if I had a question, I would go to them. If an applicant, anyone else that was there that was not easily identifiable by me as a staff member, I would refer them to that person. I think that not just the touchy-feely type of thing, but to visually stand geographically in a place where either a monopole is going up or something else is important. And I love Roger, but it does make common sense to me that, you know, any question that I had, I would fall back on when I was at the official public meeting. And in that context, as long as we have staff members there that we can go to or point it, someone in that direction to have a subsequent conversation with. I would like to continue site visits, and under the new language does not bother me at all. And I would like to compliment staff on the ones that I have been at. Thank you.
Thanks. Michael?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just to clarify, this is not to, I'm assuming this is not meant to suggest that we can't have any communication whatsoever to site visit.
No.
But rather, because we can ask clarifying questions, such as, you say that's a hill, I thought it was a knoll.
Right.
As opposed to, what could that hill, could the applicant use that hill for said purpose? Now we're getting into deliberation.
That's right.
So we can still have clarifying questions with regard to the elements
to the
of the site.
Yes.
Landscape,
yep.
What we see. I think I agree with everything you're putting down here for us to consider with regard to protecting the integrity of the process, and so that we refrain from any deliberations that are outside of the place and time where the deliberations should occur.
There are 6 trees there and 75 trees. Okay. Please continue. I'm sorry.
I have presented the entire document. I know we've taken questions throughout, so I don't know if there's any other discussions you may want to have.
Are there any other questions?
Mr. Chairman?
None. I'll just make a statement, a general statement, that there's a large body of law that has nothing to do with common sense.
There's your thesis.
Roger?
Wasn't it Oliver Wendell Holmes who said the law was an ass on occasion?
I have a motion.
Yes. Okay, go ahead, please.
Move to approve and incorporate the amendments to the subcommittee procedures.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
With some of the language that we have suggested from the commission, yes.
Including the amendments that have been discussed on the floor.
Yes,
yes, thank you. Yeah.
Okay. All in favor will signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Passed.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Next, we have Cape Cod 2011 Regional Transportation Plan. Glenn.
Thank you. For the record, Glenn Cannon, Director of Technical Services for the Cape Cod Commission, and I am here to talk to you about the Regional Transportation Plan, which I have tried to present a few times now, and I'm going to get to it today. And I do hope it will be brief, and if it isn't brief enough, I will even go faster. Because I know we've been here for a while now. This is just an introduction to the Regional Transportation Plan, some of the highlights of it. I think the main reason of why we're doing this Regional Transportation Plan is that for the region to receive any federal funding for highway projects, that project needs to be incorporated into the Regional Transportation Plan. That makes this Regional Transportation Plan extremely comprehensive and extremely wide-reaching. That makes our task very difficult. That makes our work outreach to the community even more important than we normally see. So we try to take a wide swath with this plan and incorporate many facets of the population and the transportation modes as we can. I would like to say that Mr. Malikoff, Lev Malikoff, Commission staff, he's done a majority of this work for the Regional Transportation Plan. I'd like to recognize his efforts because it does all start with the planning process. Again, we spend a lot of time reaching out to individual groups. I know you can't read the print here, but we are trying to reach out to as many transportation groups as possible. That's the Joint Transportation Committee, the Metropolitan Planning Organization, bike groups, highway groups within your town, safety committee groups that we can reach out to, public organizations. Again, we're trying to reach out to as many groups as possible to get feedback on this plan that we can. The most important of all of them, I'm sorry, just some of the participating members here. Certainly the Metropolitan Planning Organization, had John Harris sits on from the commission. Government agencies, we're always reaching out to our MassDOT, local representatives, just to get input from them, make sure that our plan is in concert with their plans. Again, I do want to stress that it is the general public that we try to reach out to the most. It's great to sit around with transportation engineers and talk about transportation engineering, but that really isn't our calling. Our calling is to bring back public feedback from the public to these transportation providers to make sure that our plans incorporate their visions. Some of the key issue areas that we're always looking for in our highway plans here. You know, we're always looking at that multimodal focus to make sure that we have incorporated transit, bicycle, pedestrians, and rail, well, rail, air, and water service here, too. Again, it is contact-sensitive design that you always see on Cape Cod. I think that is probably true throughout the Northeast, just to make sure that you are not degrading public resources that people want to incorporate into their plans. The complete streets concept, again, this kind of gets back to having the public road utilized by different segments of the population, be they bicyclists, pedestrians, or motor vehicle users. The climate change impacts, we've been looking at lately with our federal partners to make sure that our regional transportation plan is in concert with what we think is going to happen into the future here, and to make sure we're not planning facilities in the wrong location. Existing conditions, again, we spend a lot of time looking at our existing conditions to make sure we have an assessment of what's happening out there on the street today. I won't go through every single one of these, but these are, again, the partners that we reach out to. Chapter 3, always the most important for us as transportation professionals. We're always looking at safety of the roadway segments to make sure we're addressing safety out there on the street. These are, again, from the public comment forum. These are the top locations in selected towns here, just to identify to you some of the locations that people find of a concern. We make sure that they are incorporated into the plan and addressed in our planning process. Chapter 4 with security, what we really find in our role is assisting public emergency agencies with intelligent transportation system. That's really where our role comes into, giving them the information that they need to respond to emergencies. We do this primarily, I would say, through the canal area with cameras, identifying backups, assisting the MassDOT with those camera locations, assisting them with funding for those projects, helping to get those projects online, again, so we can assist the emergency responders. Chapter 5, bicycle and pedestrians. Again, we have a shared use path vision plan right now to bring pedestrian and bicycle facilities throughout Cape Cod. We really focused on this plan as staff because through the complete streets concept, many of the projects that come through from MassDOT, they have on-road facilities to address pedestrian and bicycle facilities. This is a plan right here with the shared use that's a multi-use path. It's separate from the roadway. It's for a different class of bike user, a different class of pedestrian. So we want to make sure that they're incorporated also. They're included in our plans. So we're stepped out specifically to address that need. And I seem to have frozen up. There we go. Congestion management, again, I think, you know, congestion is always a problem on Cape Cod. Looking at some of the higher congestion areas that you see on Cape Cod, I think they're probably no surprise. This, again, from the public input that we get back from users here, probably some of the higher congestion areas that you see on Cape Cod that we do try to address through the plan. Chapter 7, alternatives of analysis. Really, you see different categories in here. Again, it is a plan that is very wide-reaching. We try to incorporate as many different facets as we can, so that gives us many different programs. You'll see 34 different transportation programs to make sure that those programs are addressed in the plan. Again, if you had a project that came forward that is not in the regional transportation plan, then it cannot receive federal funding. Most, almost all, except for maybe Chapter 90 projects, there is some component of federal funding in that project, so that project needs to be either in a program or a project. Very, very important. A couple of the transportation programs, again, it's the road rehabilitation and reconstruction. It's really repaving. This is particularly with your national highway system that MassDOT incorporates, or even the Chapter 90 money goes to a lot to this. And then the bridge programs, so I should flap too. I'm sorry, the rehabilitation, again, it's mostly repaving, making sure that what we have right now is maintained properly. And then, of course, the bridge program. You know, I think we all see the ramifications of maybe something we take for granted every single day, and that's the roadway bridge that we cross every day. Until this bridge goes down for repairs or it's taken out of service, and then we see the backups and the detours associated with that, you know, these can be significant. I think we saw that recently last year with the work on the Sagamore Bridge, you know, just how significant that is. Again, 32 additional transportation programs here. I don't expect you to read the list, but there is everything from access management to underground utilities and pole relocation. Again, very comprehensive. Some of the projects that we have specifically listed here, the Hyannis Access Study and then the Cape Cod Rail Trail extensions. Two significantly different projects here, but both very important to the region. Again, the Hyannis Access project here, we're working this through with MassDOT and the town of Barnstable, with many different transportation providers here. You know, you do have you have rail service here, you have the plane service, the bus service here, all in this one area, to make sure they're all incorporated, as well as pedestrian and bicycle facilities. There is a significant amount of pedestrian activity and bicycle activity through the airport rotary, which amazes me every time I see it, due to what I perceive danger of it. Again, the Cape Cod Rail Trail extensions here, the plan that we're working on. Currently, the towns of Yarmouth and Dennis have a plan to extend the Cape Cod Rail Trail to Willow Street in Yarmouth. Those plans are currently under design and will be brought forward through the TIP. But once again, if they aren't thought of and brought forward now through the Regional Transportation Plan, they are not allowed to receive that federal funding. So as we move forward to extend those plans, we need to make sure that that planning process has been thought of. And this is the, I'd say this is the first stage of it right now. Many of these planning projects need to be brought out into the public atmosphere. They need to be specifically brought down to the town level, so you're having those discussions with the local participants. But they need to be thought of first here. Additional transportation projects, again, we have 137 of them. If you go back to the first slide, one of the things about the Regional Transportation Plan, it is financially constrained, so we have to rank these projects and make sure that we have the money to pay for these projects out to a future year. But, you know, again, some of the projects that are in front of us, the Bourne Rotary improvements and then Shank Painter Road corridor improvements, you know, everything from $1 million here to a $20 million project. Some of the smart solutions, I think this body probably sees a lot of the smart solutions in the DRI decisions, where we're looking at employee trip reduction plans. We consider that to be a smart solution. We're trying to get people out of their automobiles and traveling some other way. But again, you know, zoning has a big play in that. The planning process for sidewalks, how you plan your town center, has a significant impact on the transportation aspects of it. And right now, the Regional Transportation Authority and the Steamship Authority are working together on a coordination program, where to make sure that when the ferry comes into the dock, that the RTA buses are waiting there for the recipients to get off of that ferry and to be able to take them to their destination. You know, it sounds simple, but it's a very important aspect of the transportation network to make sure that those schedules are aligned. The zoning planning and support for sidewalks, again, you know, they have that dense downtown area where you can come in, park your car once, and to make sure you can walk around that village center. You know, this is an important thing for us, much different than having your unplanned development where you're literally driving from one development to the next development. Again, the ferry coordination here, you know, this is probably also the ITS system, where they are showing on a map where the ferry boats are coming in to the station, and then also when the buses are coming into the station, so you can coordinate your trip. 19 additional smart solutions. Again, I think this group sees the employee TDM plans. Those are the trip reduction plans we bring in front of you. And then even the Wi-Fi hotspots, which we hear people talk about when they're looking for public transit. I think that's one of the benefits of public transit, is that you can work while you ride. So that's an additional benefit that many commuters are looking for. Transportation studies. We are looking at the Cape Cod Canal Bridge Replacement Study. This is a wide-reaching study to see the effects of what would happen if the bridges were to be replaced, or if planning were in place for the bridge replacements, and also the significant infrastructure that's needed to attach to those bridges, and the replacement of those approaches. Again, the Cape Cod Canal area, you know, not only is it the bridges, it is also, you know, exit 1 on Route 6, the Bourne Rotary and then Belmont Circle on the north side. Those three quadrants really haven't been addressed in the canal area, so that's a significant planning process that's currently underway. South side bike route, this is something that's been discussed for a long time. A lot of it is along Route 28, so it becomes, again, hazardous for certain type of bike users. There are, you know, the serious bike user who doesn't mind being in the roadway, but many of the recreational bike users want to be off of Route 28. They're looking for alternatives to Route 28, a lower volume roadway, a safer roadway. Again, additional ones, disaster emergency security plan, always important on Cape Cod, always important to work with our partners there to make sure that the transportation planning is in line with what they're looking to do. The exit six park and ride lot expansion, a project that's been on the table for quite some time now. We continue to have discussions on this park and ride lot to move it forward. The next steps for us on the regional transportation plan, some of the important things, there's the JTC meeting tomorrow. We will introduce many of the projects and the studies that go into the regional transportation plan, looking for the JTC to at least give us some guidance on make sure we're going in the right direction. We bring their comments back, we analyze those again, go back to the JTC on June 10th. At the June 10th, we'll look for the JTC to endorse the regional transportation plan to bring it to the MPO, the Metropolitan Planning Organization, on June 27th. That's an important step for us. It is the MPO that can release the regional transportation plan to the public. Up to that point, we are not allowed by law to release the document as a draft form. That's why you don't have a draft form to look at today. But on June 27th, hopefully, it will be released. That's our schedule looking for right now. We do plan on having a public meeting mid-July just to get public input, again, back on that draft document, even though we've been working with the public throughout the process, but to make sure that the comments that we've received up to this point are reflected in that document. And then we are looking for the Metropolitan Planning Organization to endorse it in August 2011. Which point it'll go forward to the federal government for their endorsement also. If there is any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. I believe that's the end of the presentation. If not, I would welcome you to come to our public informational meeting, and we'll be happy to give you more detail then. I'm sure that meeting will go on much longer than this one.
Joanne?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to say thank you to your work, Glenn, and the rest of the RTP in helping us in Sandwich for our bike pathways. And we do have a new member, and I was thinking that perhaps if you told the complexion of the board for the JTC and the MPO and how that works, it may be somewhat helpful.
Sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, I guess a couple of things. Like you say, Joanne, as it goes on right now, as transportation planning projects go forward right now, what we're really looking to do is we're always looking to update the regional transportation plan. So those plans will be incorporated into the regional transportation plan for future years. But on the JTC, it is primarily DPW directors who sit on that board, generally transportation professionals. Again, we bring back the public input that we have so they don't have to attend every public hearing that we do, bring that feedback back to them, though. But it is transportation professionals who are accustomed to probably the scope and the cost of transportation projects. They assist us with ranking the projects and how they move forward to the Metropolitan Planning Organization. The Metropolitan Planning Organization is a body of transportation professionals, from MassDOT sits on it, but also elected representatives from the subregions of Cape Cod. There is a selectman from four different subregions on Cape Cod, the Upper Cape, there's a representative from the town of Barnstable as our only designated city. Then there is a Mid-Cape representative and then an Outer Cape representative. I'm sorry, Liv, we just also added a separate, we just split the Outer Cape.
Well, there's Lower Cape and Outer Cape separately.
Lower Cape and Outer Cape. So the MPO is more of a political body, but the MPO has a very important process here or determination, because they are the ones who release the document and endorse it. So it is their final say that gives support to projects and then and the ranking of those projects.
I know you referred to several projects, concerns in the Bourne area, but you did not say the name that I was hoping you would say in terms of MacArthur Boulevard. I know it must be included in that, but I think that has such distinct problems, it needs to be identified as the problems with MacArthur Boulevard and, you know, that something happened in that direction.
It really is. Again, when you go back and look at the canal area, you can't look at the canal area in isolation. You certainly have to look at, you know, exit one on Route 6. And as we look through this process, even though it's a fairly new, you also want to look at the north side, the replacement of the Sagamore Road, just to make sure that things are functioning properly there. You have to look at both bridges. You have to look at the connection between the bridges. And I would agree with you. I believe you have to look at MacArthur Boulevard south of the Bourne Bridge, all the way down to the Otis Rotary. You know, that is a significant component to what happens in Bourne. We never want to lose sight of that.
Yeah. I think what's there needs to be seen from the point of view that it's really not fair to the motoring public to have to drive there. And it creates problems that come out of the bigger problems. But anyway, excuse me. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I hope I didn't say anything you didn't want me to say.
I would never presume, Mr. Chairman, but no, thank you for opening up the question with regard to Bourne. I know we've spoken that it's important also, not just with Bourne, but with any of the townships, that there are several stakeholders that probably need to be consolidated with regard to their valuable inputs. I know in Bourne, certainly we've got the Board of Selectmen, the DPW, and other stakeholder interests in developing and consolidating traffic in those areas. I'm sure it's the same in just about every other town that my fellow representatives represent as well.
Yeah, I will apologize. You know, one thing about it is this is an overview that, you know, that's 100 miles out here. As we bring any of these projects forward, you know, we get deeper and deeper into the local community and increase our amount of public participation, particularly on the local level, because I think that's always key to any significant public infrastructure project. And you have to bring it down to people who are impacted by that every single day.
Did you have something you wanted to say, Paul?
No, just that Michael shouldn't kid himself. Bourne really is different when it comes to transportation issues, just because of the bridges and the canal. I mean, significantly different challenges.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for your time, then. We appreciate it.
All right. Is there any other business to come before the group? Hearing none. Any Cape Cod Commission member comments in addition to what we've heard? Would somebody move that we adjourn?
So moved.
Seconded? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.